Welcome to Yesterday Today, where we talk about the crazy things that happened yesterday, today. The person we're going to be talking about today is Léo Major. It's like if Rambo and John Wick had a baby that was Canadian and hated the Nazis. Léo Major was born in 1921 to French-Canadian parents. Shortly after that, they moved to Montreal. Léo Major would be the first of 13 children because apparently they were trying to field a baseball team with some spares. Now, Léo Major left home at around 14 years old to move in with his aunt because his father was, let's just go with mean, because it's way nicer than what he was. Despite his father's behavior, young Léo Major was always trying to make his father proud. And because of this, he joined up with the army at 19 years old in 1940, which is like the worst time to join, next to being an American in the 60s and deciding to join. Not only was Léo Major joining the army in 1940, so he was just guaranteed to fight the Nazis, but his first action was actually in 1944 in June. June 6th, to be specific, also known as D-Day. During the chaos of the Normandy landings, Léo Major decided then and there, well, this is where I'm gonna start being awesome. Léo and his unit started making their way inwards, at which point they encountered a German half-tank, which is like a halfsies tank? Now, Léo sees this and just takes it over, capturing the Germans, including their code books and maps and a whole bunch of other things. The Allies were like, oh, yes, we need that. Now, he decided they need to bring the whole half-track back with him to carry all the stuff, so he just orders the Germans to start driving towards the Canadian lines. Now, the British and the Canadians see a German halfsies tank just driving towards them, so they start shooting at it. But they keep missing, and so Léo decides, well, there's only one way to let them know this is a good tank, so he gets on the top of it and starts flagging them down to be like, it's fine. His direct quote after that was, "Thank God the British and the Canadians can't shoot." A few days later, Léo Major was scouting ahead of his unit, and he came across an SS patrol. The SS was like the regular Nazis, but if they had extra training and super racism. Now, at that point, Léo opens fire on them, killing four of them, but one of them, while mortally wounded, throws a phosphorus grenade, and it blows up, damaging the left side of his face. Shortly after being injured, Léo Major was taken to a Canadian field hospital, where he was given an eye patch so that his left eye could begin to heal. At that point, he said candidly that he looked like a pirate. Now, the doctors after that were like, "Look, man, you've been injured, you can go home." To which point he responded, "No, I only need one good eye to shoot," which he then proved by being a sniper and a scout for the rest of the war. I assume the doctor's checkout had to go a little something like this. "Hi, Léo, here's your sling, and here's your eye patch." And then he was probably like, "What's the sling for?" And the doctors had to look at him straight-faced and be like, "For your massive balls." Léo Major was then sent back into the field because he decided he hadn't achieved the level of awesome he quite wanted yet. So then he decided to capture 93 Germans by himself on a solo reconnaissance mission. So this is how it goes down. Léo Major is out by himself in the south of the Netherlands. It is cold and is wet outside. Apparently he is muttering to himself when he sees two German soldiers. And then he says to himself, "I am cold and wet because of you. Now you must pay." Like the absolute king of petty. So Léo captures one of the Germans and decides to use him as bait to capture the other one. Yes, he went fishing with people. But the second German wasn't great at being a fish, so he tried to shoot Léo. Léo then shot him, looked back at his bait, and was like, "You're not done being bait yet." Léo then told bait to take him to his commanding officer. Bait obliged, and by the time they got to the commanding officer was already asleep. So Léo woke him up by putting his gun in his face, which definitely got the message across. Now, just to clarify, at this point, there is one Canadian standing around about 100 Germans, and three of them were like, "We can really kill this guy, right?" Which they tried to, but Léo killed them all first. At this point, the rest of the German garrison looked around and were like, "We didn't even like those guys. Yeah, we'll come with you." So at this point, Léo starts walking back the nearly 100 Germans he's captured. And at this point, the German SS sees that their other comrades have surrendered. And enraged, they start shooting at the German Wehrmacht troops that were trying to surrender. This serves as a reminder that during World War II, there were scales of evil. And the Waffen-SS was just the absolute worst. They would even kill their own Germans just to prove a point. As Léo's walking back his now 93 German prisoners because a few of them had been killed by the Waffen-SS, he's passing a Canadian tank, at which point he says, "That's where the SS is. Fire." And they do. After the Canadian tank fired at the Waffen-SS, we assume that that's the inspiration that served for the song "Raining Men" by the Weather Girls. Now, Léo brings back his nearly two American football teams of German prisoners, and his people are stunned. At this point, everyone is just so stunned by how amazing Léo Major is, they offer him the Distinguished Conduct Medal, which is second only to the Victoria Cross. He would be the only Canadian to get one during World War II and Korea, but he declines this one because it was going to be given to him by Field Marshal Montgomery, who he deemed as incompetent and in no place to be giving out medals. Gosh, is his sling broken yet? In February of 1945, Léo was helping a chaplain load a Bren carrier with corpses so they could be properly taken care of. Now, as they started to drive away, they hit a landmine. Léo was sitting in the back of the Bren carrier and is thrown like 55 feet. He breaks both of his ankles, his ribs, and then like three vertebrae in his back, but survives and is taken 30 miles to a field hospital. Now at this point, death is starting to fear Léo Major because he just seems to be unkillable. The doctors had to see him coming back in and be like, "Not this guy again, what does he need, a bigger sling?" At that point, Léo sat there for 2 months, recuperated, and demanded to be sent back out into the action. He had broken both of his ankles. the things needed to walk. And he was like, that won't slow me down. And it didn't. Now it's at this point in our story where Léo Major goes from amazing war hero to Call of Duty protagonist. Léo Major and his best friend Willy Arsenault volunteered to scout the city of Zwolle, Netherlands. The Canadians had planned to use an artillery strike to rid it of the Germans, but that would have destroyed a lot of the city in the process. Both Léo and Willy decided that they didn't want to see the city destroyed, so they're like, why don't we just take it by ourselves? There's two of us. On the night of April 13th, 1945, Arsenault and Major began to sneak their way through the outskirts of the city. Now, as they were going through the trees, at one point, one of Arsenault's bags, specifically his grenade bag, made a jostling sound. The German sentries heard it, they shot and killed him immediately. Little did those Germans know it, but that was the worst and last mistake of many of their lives. At that point, Léo Major returns fire, killing two of the Germans, but a few of them escape in the car. At that point, he takes Arsenault's machine gun and his grenade bag and begins making his way towards the city. And vengeance! Now, at this point, Léo Major switched from Bruce Banner to the Incredible Hulk. He notices a German car, sneaks, sits in the back seat, and puts a gun to the driver's head and says, take me to your leader. Which is a crazy thing to say. He also relieves him of his machine gun, so at this point, Léo Major has three submachine guns. The German driver very quickly realizes that he is not the protagonist of our story. He is a background character that could be easily eliminated. So he listens to Léo Major and drives into the center of the city at a bar where their commander had been sitting. Our French-Canadian hero Léo Major takes his hostage into the bar with him, sits down with the German officer, relieves him of his handgun, and turns out that German officer also speaks French. During their conversation, Léo Major tells the German commanding officer that they are planning to shell the city the next morning, and not so subtly hints that he should grab all of his Germans and leave, at which point he then hands him back his handgun as a sign of good faith. Just to clarify, he threatened a guy and then gave him a gun. What, is he invincible? What's going on here? At this point, the German commanding officer realizes he's dealing with probably the scariest person he will ever come across in his life, so he takes Leo's previous hostage, they get in the car, and they start driving away. Though the retreat order is given, some units of the Wehrmacht, the Gestapo, and the SS stayed around, which Léo Major decided just simply would not do. So Léo Major starts running through the town, throwing grenades at random and shooting at anything that might like schnitzel. He also begins to capture just a plethora of Germans. Léo started capturing so many Germans that every time he got a group together of 8 to 10, again, one guy, capturing double digits of people, he would just take them back to the Canadian lines, like a really aggressive field trip, like the Rambo Miss Frizzle. He did this 8 to 10 times, capturing anywhere from 64 to 100 Germans, again, alone. During the night, Léo found a Gestapo headquarters, which were the German secret police, and he just burned down their headquarters. Because why not? Why not? After lighting the German secret police headquarters on fire, making it a beacon, which is just so funnily ironic, he then decided, wait, there's still some SS guys. Better go find him and kill him. So he found the SS headquarters, busted in, killed four of them, and discovered papers that they were trying to infiltrate the Dutch resistance, which he foiled by himself. At this point during the night, Léo Major runs across some Dutch citizens, which turns out to be some of the Dutch resistance. He then partners with them to take back City Hall. Major then tells the Dutch resistance about his friend Arsenault's body, of which they go and retrieve it so that it may be properly buried. Léo Major then returns to Canadian lines around 4 a.m., having successfully liberated an entire city by himself. What's most amazing about this story is the Germans that were captured or retreated, because no one would ever believe their story. So let me get this straight. You're telling me that a Canadian pirate made a machine gun jacket, carried around a sack of grenades, invaded an entire city by himself, made everyone think it was a full army, captured 100 people, killed the worst of the worst, and then went home. Nah. Léo Major was yet again offered the Distinguished Conduct Medal, which this time he did accept. And that would be the end of his World War II antics. Until the Korean War, where he fought up 10,000 Chinese with 20 soldiers when he was told to retreat, but didn't, and won. Does this guy, is he, what's he in his, what is he drinking? What's he got? I need protein by Léo. It would be a big thing. Anyway, after fighting off an army 500 times his size, he was given yet again another Distinguished Conduct Medal, which he accepted, being the only Canadian to get a Distinguished Conduct Medal in World War II and in Korea. Just amazing. On October 12, 2008, death approached Léo Major once more and politely asked if he wouldn't mind just going with him this time, but it's okay if he says no, in which Léo Major replied, that'll be okay. Léo Major died on October 12th, 2008 at 87 after living a full and amazing life.
Thanks so much for watching Yesterday Today. If you liked the video, feel free to subscribe and stick around or go check out some more of our videos.